Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this online conversation with the artist Kenneth Tam. My name is Kyung An. I'm an assistant curator of Asian art here at the Guggenheim Museum. And today I am wearing a red blouse, sitting in front of my fireplace with a Christmas garland behind me for some festive flair. And as you can hear from my accent, I grew up in London, but I am Korean by birth. Today, we're delighted to be in discussion about Kenneth Tam's new work, Silent Spikes, together here with the artist and Sophia Marisa Lucas, who is an assistant curator at the Queen's Museum. We'd like to thank the Guggenheim Museum's Asian Art Circle and the Queen's Museum for their support of this fantastic program and for making Silent Spikes possible. Silent Spikes will be available for viewing. It's on view now. So if you go onto our website, you can see it. And it's available to view until 7 p.m. on Saturday, December the 12th. So don't miss it. I'm gonna start with some introductions, obviously. First, Kenneth Tam. Tam's work takes the form of video installations that include moving image works and sculpture and explores gender performativity and broader themes of the negotiations of identity. His works have been exhibited at the Sculpture Center, MIT List Visual Arts Center, and the Hammer Museum, amongst other museums and institutions. And he's also participated in numerous residencies, including one at the Kitchen, where he just produced his first live streamed performance called The Crossing. And we're actually going to talk about that amazing work a little later on. Also at the Lower Manhattan Cultural Council, Pioneer Works, etc. Kenneth, do you want to quickly say hello and describe yourself?
Thanks for that lovely introduction, Kyung. So my name is Kenneth Tam. I am Chinese American. I'm currently in my apartment in Brooklyn. I'm wearing a mustard yellow sweatshirt, medium length black hair, brownish glasses, sitting in front of my bookcase next to a fake fireplace.
You have a fake fireplace. Mine doesn't work either, but yeah. Thank you, Kenneth. And I just want to add that our history with Kenneth began when I first saw his work in LA almost 2 years ago now, which led to inviting Kenneth to our Summer of Nerd program last year, where we talked about actually topics that we'll be touching upon today, you know, Asian American masculinity, what is it, what could it be? And this was actually followed by an acquisition of a work by him through the Young Collectors Council. And it's really a delight to be able to deepen our relationship with you through the Asian Art Circle. To our next guest, Sophia. Sophia Marisa Lucas is an assistant curator at the Queen's Museum, where she has organized and supported over 20 exhibitions, including the Ulrika Müller and Amy Zion, The Conference of the Animals, American Artist, My Blue Window, Queen's International 2018, which was co-organized with the artist Bazira Khan, the eighth iteration of the museum's biannual exhibition of Queens-based artists mounted in partnership with the Queen's Public Library. Her upcoming projects include the newly commissioned projects by Kenneth Tam. That's why we're joined by Sophia here today, and QM Jerome Fellow Sydney Shen. Sophia, do you want to quickly say hello and also describe yourself as well?
Thank you. Thanks, Kyung. I am, as Kyung said, assistant curator at the Queen's Museum. I am a Portuguese American female in my mid-30s. And today I'm wearing a black turtleneck. My hair is pulled back. And I'm against a far less interesting background, just a plain wall. I'm very happy to be here today in conversation.
Great. So we don't have a lot of time, so let's jump in. Kenneth, we're so excited to learn more about Silent Spikes. I myself have been hearing about it for like over a year, so it was very exciting to be able to see the final cut a few days ago. And I really just wondered if we could start with, you know, the origin of the project and what you wanted to explore and investigate through this particular work. While you speak, I am going to be in charge of the PowerPoint, so I will pull up.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, so
we have to start here.
Of course, yes, with embarrassing adolescent painting. So this project has been in development for quite a while. Actually, today I think marks like the 1 year, not really anniversary, but the first time I got my participants together was pretty much 1 year ago exactly today, where we did our first shoot. But it's been in development even before that, obviously. And this project came about, you know, as a continuation of previous work, previous interest in the performance of masculinity, how men in groups sort of decide how they want to perform in front of each other. And, you know, again, these broader ideas about the negotiation of identity in general. These are things that I was investigating in previous works, and I wanted to do that with a bit more sort of cultural specificity, let's say. Looking specifically at Asian American men and working with that group and trying to sort of even understand like what that might mean and how that might appear, you know, in front of a camera, let's say. And we're looking at these two images right now because, so the image on the left is a painting I made while I was in high school. The one on the right is part of the sort of the classic Marble Man campaign, which I think for people of a certain generation that are familiar with these images, typified this quintessential sort of American rugged masculinity. But obviously, you know, very, packaged and built around this very sort of white notion of maleness and the expectations around that image were something that I somehow came up, you know, into contact with. I don't know exactly what, you know, compelled me to make that, except that I thought it was like a fascinating image. And here's another one, and I made a whole series of these terrible things. My parents still keep them, and you know, I guess it's handy for occasions like this, but I guess even at a young age, these again mythological images of these men, you know, seem somehow important or worth spending time to reproduce. And I didn't make these paintings because I knew who Richard Prince was. Like, I was not that savvy at all. So my attraction to them was far more sort of instinctual. It wasn't some sort of ironic gesture. It was like really being sucked into whatever this image sort of meant and the carefully crafted idea of sort of Western rugged masculinity, you know, somehow got a hold of me. And, you know, this painting came from that. And so thinking from this painting, I started to think, well, where do sort of Asian men, you know, just again, using myself as the kind of the filter for this question, like where do I, let's say, fit in with this image, you know? Could an Asian man, you know, be a cowboy, right? Could we also inhabit and put on that costume, and what would that mean? You know, would it be silly? Would it be farcical? Could it be, you know, could we ever sort of embody the same kinds of qualities that were so, you know, carefully crafted within these images? So, you know, from that somewhat, you know, perhaps clumsy question came a larger project built around trying to reimagine what that might be, what Asian masculinity actually might be. And this certainly piggybacks off of the conversation we had it was only last summer. And you know, these broader questions of representation and then also, you know, in thinking about, you know, a kind of fictional Asian American cowboy, I started thinking about the history of Asian men in the West, historically in this country. And that, you know, naturally led me to the history of the Transcontinental Railroad and the use of imported Chinese labor. And from all of this came this video, I guess, or the framework for creating silent spikes.
Mm-hmm. Just for viewers, we're looking at a clip, some clips from Silent Spikes here right now that Kenneth shared with us. And I guess, Kenneth, do you want to kind of tell us a little bit about who these figures are that we see on screen and what they're doing?
Yeah, so these are all men, self-identified Asian American men who I met through various internet posting sites. I also put out a notice on various actor casting call spaces. So some of these, so I work with a group of five or six men, but ultimately it was really a core group of five. Not all of them are actors. You know, some were certainly just people who were interested in the project. And that's typically the kind of person that I've been working with on these kinds of videos, individuals who, you know, for their own reasons, decide that they want to spend time creating this thing with me. And this group of five men, they were involved in doing a number of different activities, mostly in sound stages this time. A lot of had to do with COVID and adjusting to that after March, but certainly some scenes outdoors. And again, doing a lot of things that are typical of my other work, which is working in a very unrehearsed, unscripted way with each other, trying to, I don't know if provoke is the right word, but trying to get them to sort of allow for sort of more intimate or vulnerable version of themselves to come out on camera through some of the prompts, through some of the activities I've given them. But I think that this project though is a bit more cinematic in terms of the visual language. It's certainly not just built upon improvised performances. There's a lot of movement that happens. I wouldn't call it dance necessarily, but I work with a choreographer, her name is Alyssa Forte, and she really helped me to sort of help my participants sort of find some sort of inner language based upon movement. And that was really sort of fundamental to how I thought I could sort of create a different version of Asian American masculinity. Mm-hmm. Through physical acts, but also, you know, some sort of dialogue-based activities as well.
And could you elaborate a little bit on the dialogue? Because I found that a very interesting, almost continuation from your previous works, like the dialogue that you encourage between the men. And yes, there's the physical movement that reveals somewhat, you know, uncomfortableness or, you know, veering away from whenever we veer away from like social norms of, you know, how we're supposed to behave with each other. You know, that's definitely there, but I feel like the dialogue itself was very interesting in this particular piece. And there's a particular, you know, question around sensuality that you pose all of them. Do you think you can elaborate a bit on that?
Yeah, definitely. So there are scenes that are them just speaking as themselves. Well, no, I should say they're always speaking as themselves, sometimes with a certain prompt. But I would say that there are scenes where they're speaking with each other, let's say dressed in this sort of cowboy clothing. And in those scenes, that was actually kind of informed by the more cinematic representations of the cowboy. So constructing, you know, things that look like they could be taken from a Western film, let's say, that like, you know, wooden fence railing as a prop. And getting to, I think the prompts for that were just to have them speak very frankly to one another, but what they found positive or affirming about one another. Things that I've done it in previous projects, and you know, the reason I asked them to do that is because I feel like that's something that they probably would not do with each other unprompted. And I always find that it takes them into a slightly uncomfortable place, but also a far more sort of vulnerable space. And that's the kind of image that I've always been interested in creating with my participants. So those verbal prompts are always about taking them, getting them to put, you know, to articulate things that they would normally not do with each other, and certainly not in front of a camera. And then there are scenes where the men are just speaking individually in a kind of interview style format, and they're just talking about their own experiences. And usually the prompt for that was to actually have them respond to this idea of sensuality or sensuousness, and have them sort mm-hmm. of talk about whatever those words meant to them. And that's something that I thought was also an important through line for how I wanted to reimagine whatever this idea of Asian American masculinity might be.
I thought we could just play just two examples of your previous work, just because your work so, you know, video-based works, I think rather than seeing stills, it's always more exciting for people to get a sense of your work through the moving images. I'm just gonna play All of M, which is a Guggenheim collection work. And I wondered if you could quickly talk about this particular work and how it kind of, I don't know, not led you to this, you know, silent spikes, but the as you called it, you know, the through line, what the work, how the work relates to, you know, silent spikes.
Yes, yeah, so this is All of Emma watching an early part of the video. So in this video, I gathered a group of men also through these sort of similar online postings and whatnot. And I was interested in the ritual of the prom, using that as a way to sort of unpack ideas about male expression, let's say. And some were actually high school students, some were adults, but I had them dress up in these tuxedos. And in this particular scene, I asked them to do something for the camera that they thought was, I think I just had them look handsome. And so they, they already know kind of what that means, right? There's already sort of like internal scripting that comes through in terms of how they should position their bodies and the kinds of gestures they should be making. And it's a little goofy and silly, but I think it says so much about how they think they're expected to perform themselves, particularly in a group setting. So this video was trying to use to look at social ritual and to kind of reimagine that ritual as a way to also probe at a certain kind of gender performance. And,
right. I mean, the prom is this kind of one night where you dress up as adults, and it's this, you know, huge rite of passage, especially here in America. Anyway, I mean, I grew up in London, so prom didn't really exist, but I think that, you know, it's still a universal, you know, rite of passage for those of us who grew up watching all those movies about proms. The anxieties around it and having to perform this, form of adulthood, womanhood, manhood that you are imagining.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's exactly right. You know, there is this theatricality that's already built into the event, you know, even for the people that experience it for the first time. And it also is something that is very much filtered through cinema or, you know, popular culture. Those forms really give rise to a global understanding of what prom is. And certainly the Western is constructed in a similar way, but certainly in an American export that has found versions of itself in every country in the world, let's say. So it's an idea that, you know, has purchased here, but certainly, you know, is disseminated all over the place. And sometimes in contexts that, you know, don't fully understand what this means. So it's interesting to see how people sort of can reimagine it. And I guess I was trying to do that within this video.
Yeah. And then just because we mentioned your most recent project, you know, during your residency at the Kitchen, for those of you who weren't able to see it, we just wanted to share a clip and have Kenneth talk about it. I think the works, you know, you've talked about movement just now and how that's been so integral to this particular work. And I can't imagine, you know, the two being considered separately because movement's so, you know, powerfully present in this particular work that you worked on.
Yeah, so the crossing was developed over my 5-week residency at the Kitchen, a Queen's lab, and it looks at ritual and ceremony within Asian American fraternities. And also there are the sort of prevalence of young men dying within the hazing portion of fraternity initiations. So there are some, you know, real life, I guess, not stories, but events that inspired this performance. And so we're looking at like the second act of it right now. And this act kind of roughly correlates to the more private portion of an initiation. And I worked with 4 dancers, which is the really kind of amazing experience. First time I've worked with actually trained bodies versus untrained bodies, which was, you know, all of my previous participants. And exploring how movement can also talk about ideas about identity, talk about the construction of it, the negotiation of it. And in this particular, my interest in the fraternity was also about how intimacy and violence get intertwined, how they are sometimes contingent upon one another, and the way that violence gets ritualized within fraternity culture as a way to create bonds between men, and why that has to be. So there are a lot of ideas behind it, but ultimately I wanted to create something about movement and seeing bodies like perform in a live space. And, you know, unfortunately the circumstances didn't allow for that, but I think, you know, we tried to do our best to convey that digitally.
Thank you. I know Sophia, we have you here, and you know, I kind of want to pull it back to Silent Spikes and its relationship, you know, to the Queen's Museum project. Obviously, you're working on this exhibition of Kenneth's work for next year. We're so excited to see it in a format that'll be very different from this virtual, you know, premiere. But before we actually talk about the particularities of that exhibition, I wondered if you could perhaps tell us why you were so drawn to Kenneth's practice and what led the Queen's Museum to really invite this particular artist and decide to show this particular work.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you wanna, okay, yeah. So I had been familiar with Ken's work a bit for a while, and you know, it was a subject matter that I feel like we at the Queen's Museum have not addressed. And so it, when the opportunity arose for us to work together, I was really excited. And I want to speak a little bit about the context of the Queen's Museum and sort of what it means for me to be working in that place, and how I feel this work is so, you know, so resonant on many levels. So the Queen's Museum, I guess we would define as kind of a community engaged, artist focused contemporary art museum. And we really strive to have our programs led by artists and informed by the various local communities that we serve. But the Queen's Museum is also a historical site several times over. And it's located, the picture that you're seeing that's imaged on the left in this slide is of the Queen's Museum with at a distance. It's located in Flushing Meadows Corona Park, which is a park that's just a bit larger than Central Park. So it really is kind of a lively, well-utilized space. It was originally built for the 1939 World's Fair, as was the Queen's Museum building. The Queen's Museum building was the New York City Pavilion at that fair. And the image you're seeing on the right is a very dramatically lit document of the symbols of that fair, which were the trilon and the perisphere. Those were, the theme of the fair was the world of tomorrow. And these were meant to be kind of utopic sculptures. There was an exhibition inside the perisphere, which was called Democross City. And so this is a very significant kind of backdrop for the fair, which took place after the Great Depression at the beginning of World War II. If we can move to the next slide. And then in 1946, the Queen's Museum building was retrofitted in the surrounding landscape to accommodate the UN General Assembly as its temporary home. So it met there from 1946 to 1950. The image on the left is the exterior view. You can see all the nation's flags were installed in front of the building. And then on the right is a image of the assembly in session. And a number of major decisions were made during those years, including the UN Declaration of Human Rights. So again, just a very rich history there. And the next slide. And then finally, the Queen's Museum building was the New York City Pavilion for a second time at the 1964-1965 World's Fair. And that's the image that you're seeing on the left is the south facade of the building and this kind of aerial view at the fair. And then on the right is a detailed view of the panorama of the city of New York, which is perhaps the most iconic symbol, second only to the Unisphere, which is outside of our building still, from that fair, and it forms really the centerpiece of the museum, both kind of physically and kind of conceptually still. And it's this really important touchstone for us in terms of the significance of our work in relation to the urban landscape and really the systems and structures that dictate and create communities and publics. So, you know, in thinking about this particular work of Ken's, I became especially interested in it because it's such a significant intersectional look at gender expression, race, and labor economics. And, you know, in a slight departure from Ken's prior work, it has this kind of historical departure point. So there is this deep resonance there, and it also, you know, is focused on a narrative and an experience that's so connected to communities that surround the museum.
Sorry, I was muted. I think, you know, your mention of the World's Fair is something that we're gonna touch upon, just honing on in this particular historical, I guess, event that is so central to Silent Spikes, which is the story of Chinese laborers of the Transcontinental Railroad in the 1860s, and in specific, the strike, you know, by these laborers in the summer of 1867. And this is a history that, you know, has been very invisible, written out. And I know that, Kenneth, it's been very important to you, the physical site of that particular place, as well as the imagined stories of these individuals that, you know, appear as almost like fictionalized first person account in your work. So Kenneth, do you want to perhaps elaborate on that? And, you know, why was it so resonant? You know, why this particular history, you know, and let me just pull up the image of this, you know, and it's so central in your title too, Silent Spike. Mm-hmm. So perhaps you can start with the title and we can go from there.
Yeah, I think the title is definitely referencing this text, which was one of the things that I researched. You know, there's not a whole lot of literature on this topic, at least devoted specifically to the Chinese laborers on the Transcontinental. but also the name, the image that comes to mind from silent spikes, you know, both silent but also having like some kind of edge to it, I think was really resonant for me. And yeah, so you're right, like this is the, well, I always, there's research that goes into my work, but that research oftentimes is just me watching, you know, ingesting large quantities of YouTube videos or something, right? So it's not necessarily historically grounded in the same way that this project has been, and really anchored in a specific site and a specific labor history, really, in this country. And, you know, I think we all sort of know a little bit about this, that we know that, you know, the railroad was built on the backs of imported labor, specifically Chinese labor. And we also know that they've been sort of written off out of history for the most part. You know, we write them back in every now and again. I think the 150th anniversary of the driving of the Golden Spike was not too long ago. So they, you know, this stuff kind of reappears every so often, but for the most part, it gets sort of, you know, we tend not to spend too much time around it. And my interest in this was not necessarily to resuscitate this history. I think other people can do that. But really to try to, you know, imagine what these group of individuals were doing there, what it meant to be there. You know, these were thousands of men and only men that were allowed to temporarily emigrate to this country to work. And what you find through the research is that there's almost no first-person accounts of their lives there. You have stories written from the perspective of the railroad company and all the sort of the white laborers that were there, but almost no stories written from their point of view. And so I thought this was an interesting opportunity to not only include this history, and I did that by, well, I was originally going to go to the site, but due to COVID, I didn't travel there. So these two images are from a site visit I made actually a year ago. And it's in the Sierra Nevada, so kind of Northern California, almost at the border of Reno, Nevada and Truckee. Really, really beautiful kind of scenery. And the left image is of the China Wall, which is this structure that continues to exist there that was built by the laborers, this wall, the stone wall that was, I don't know the proper terminology, but like, you know, created by hand, and that continues to exist as a structure. And the image at the right is of Donner Lake, which is a beautiful lake nearby. And this is what you would see when you go to this particular site. The strike stretched for 30 miles, and I chose this one particular area to focus on because you could actually walk into the tunnels. And being in that space is really kind of impressive when you realize that these massive, you know, structures, which you could, you know, as an artist, I'm like, oh, this is, you know, land art or something. I can imagine being a double negative, but this was done by hand. There were no tools, there were no power tools that were used to excavate this. So it becomes all the more impressive when you realize the kind of labor, the kind of physical labor that was required to accomplish this feat. And so there's that history, right? Like, I think there's all this sort of academic knowledge about these men being used as labor and the subsequent waves of labor, you know, from all over the world that have been used to kind of create our version of capitalism. But I wanted to approach it slightly differently because I wanted to try to imagine how these men, the emotional lives of these men, right? We never, you know, that was one of the problems of the ways in which Asian American men are represented in general is that they're not portrayed in a way that gives them humanity. They're always just cast as stereotypes for one idea or another. And, you know, part of the history of this labor was that they were just seen as disposable labor. You know, just no matter how accomplished they were at what they were doing, and, you know, they were supposedly very good at what they were doing, they were still just sort of cogs within this much larger economic machine. So I wanted to create a different way of understanding what it might have been like in the tunnel. So I this is also something I've never done before, which is write and use language in this way. I came up with this sort of fictional narrative that incorporates actual facts, but that, you know, this first person narration of what it might have been like to be in that tunnel and kind of weave that into the larger structure of the video. So the video itself, the single channel version, starts off with the camera moving into the tunnel and then ends with us exiting. So the image on the left is actually towards the end of that space. And yes, and you know, I also I cut it so that it seems like you know there I'm showing my actors or this performer actually Andrew Chung dancing, cut also with footage of the tunnel. So it's trying to place him within it, but certainly you know he's there in two separate physical spaces. So no, I try to think about
I guess and I don't know about you, Sophia, too, but like I hadn't seen this particular dancer appear in previous parts of the work that you had shared. So it was almost like this pulling of back into the contemporary, you know, times, whereas this fictionalized narrative, you know, story is obviously, you know, set in the 19th century. And I was particularly interested, you know, before when we were talking about what we're going to talk about today, you had used, I think, the term like body as like resistance, bodies functioning to resist their instrumentalization. And I think that, I don't know, seeing this dancer perform these choreographed moves, it really, it just conjured up that particular phrase for me again.
Do you want me to speak on that?
Of course. I mean, yeah. I also want to learn because I didn't know about this particular, you know, segment. So, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, I was just really moved to know that these 3,000 laborers decided to strike and stop working for a week. And that sort of, that resistance to being marginalized or, you know, they were striking for better conditions and pay. But they, you know, in my mind, they were striking, you know, as a way to be recognized for their, you know, for their own humanity, let's say. And there's something so obviously moving about that, but also thinking about all of these bodies at rest or still, or like, how can the body sort of interrupt the forces of capitalism or of industry or of exploitation? And so, you know, not to say that the dancer on the right is necessarily doing those kinds of moves, but I was really thinking about how the body, how certain gestures can perhaps suggest a kind of resistance, or suggest a kind of reimagining of what a body is, because for these laborers, they were just, again, they were just seen as disposable units of labor. You know, they could easily be replaced, or is it just an expectation that they were interchangeable? And so, yeah, using movement to try to articulate a different way of understanding the body and of value. And so that's kind of why I created this particular sequence. But, you know, even throughout the whole video, I use movement, you know, Alyssa's sort of choreography, the way she helped me bring out these gestures in my performance, who again are not, or you know, most of them were not trained. So trying to even just reimagine how their own bodies could be used or to express themselves or how to articulate themselves. I think that's one of the ways in which I wanted to answer this question of what Asian American masculinity might be.
And obviously the railroad and the Queen's Museum have such a intimate history. Sophia, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Before I jump in to speak about the railroad at the Queen's Museum, I just want to say too, in terms of that segment and Ken's piece, it's, you know, I don't think you mentioned the music, Ken, and I think, you know, there is movement throughout the piece, and it's coupled with a kind of self-reflection of the participants as they move. And so this kind of layer, and it's their own exploration verbally and physically kind of paired. And so the layering of the music and the kind of genre, the drama it brings in, the kind of, you know, the historical resonance and kind of collective resonance that it brings, I think is a beautiful component of that segment. And it really shifts the mood and the kind of reference point in a beautiful way. So I just wanted to raise that. So yes, railroads. when Ken and I were first thinking about, okay, like Queen's Museum, the 7 train, like the lifeline of the city, and all of the, Queens being the most, one of the most diverse areas in the entire country, and all of the bodies that that train moves back and forth, and the Queens Museum is the second to last stop, and Flushing is the neighborhood that follows Corona, where the Queens Museum is, and that's where the last stop is, and that's where there is a very large East Asian immigrant population, which actually dates back to the UN being cited at the Queens Museum as a major factor in the waves of immigration that developed that community. But then I did look back to thinking about the 1939 World's Fair. Among all of the various pavilions at the fair, which kind of extolled all of the accomplishments and cultural specificity of the nations that were represented, there was a very strong emphasis on transportation. There was a part of the fair called the Transportation Zone, and within that, there was a focus on railroads. So what you're seeing on the left here is a clip from a screenshot from a pamphlet which promoted the fair, but was sponsored by the Eastern Railroads Conference. And it was actually advertising use of the railroad to travel between the World's Fair in New York City to the San Francisco International Exposition, which was concurrent with the 1939 World's Fair. And then on the right, this is a postcard which depicts the west facade of the railroad building in the Transportation Zone. And I'll talk a little bit more about the imagery in the next slide. So the building was included these murals. These are illustrations of the murals, which are of some of the murals, I should say, that which are featured in the pageant guide for a performance that also took place at the fair. And so I was particularly struck by these images and thinking about, the intersection of gendered ideas and labor and race and the kind of development of the railroad in relation to the landscape and this history that Ken was evoking. So on the left, you see this feminine archetype of the West. And of course the railroad, was developed from East to West as this kind of way to conquer the landscape beyond the settlements that had already been made. And then you see these masculine archetypes of the railroad itself as passenger service or freight. And, a particular note, of course, the female archetype has a draped robe over the lower half of her body, but the male archetypes are nude and their genitals are kind of shaped like railroad cars themselves. So there's this kind of conflation of, the building of infrastructure, the creation of these pathways across the landscape and masculine identity. Go to the next slide. So the performance that I mentioned was called Railroads on Parade. And this was a kind of spectacular retelling of the entire history of the railroad in the United States. And it was told, it was a live performance that took place throughout the fair, the year-long fair. And it involved actual rail cars, choreographed movements of the rail cars, from the earliest models of trains to locomotives. And so on the left here, you see a poster advertising this piece of theater, let's call it. And then this is an excerpt from the pageant catalog, which I'll read. Railroads on Parade records the magnificent progress of the past 110 years. It begins with the first efforts of men who, inspired with bold vision and foresight, worked to achieve it, and it leads to a glowing picture of railroad operation in the United States in 1939. It is the backbone of the country. No, even more, it is its veritable lifeblood. In its 250,000 miles of steel veins, it flows to every far corner of a far-flung land. It binds in its living, throbbing embrace, city and town and village, the open country, the forest, the moor, the forge, the factory, and the sea. And it is indeed the nation's lifeblood. If it were to die, then the nation would die. So I was particularly interested in, again, like this kind of confliction of the anatomy and this idea of you know, the landscape kind of coming to life, sort of being kind of this kind of erotic image of, in the sense of life force itself being conflated through the railroad. And then this is just a scene from the last scene of the performance with the locomotives, and you can see also the extent of the infrastructure in production that was made for the performance and the fair itself, with these bleachers and, you know, the buildings beyond and the cars. But the performance was really like, you know, it struck me reading the catalog in getting a sense of how the narrative was told. I mean, this was really a kind of heroic epic of the railroad told through these kind of top notes of American history, you know, and the narratives of canonized figures like Abraham Lincoln, et cetera. And so the erasure and coupled with this highly gendered masculine language was something that felt really, really connected and meaningful in relation to the work that Ken is doing to kind of bring those marginalized stories forward.
I guess there's so much to kind of unpack there. And I know that we've also talked about, you know, how kind of concurrent with the completion of the Transcontinental Railroad, you know, the immigration policy of the US, I mean, it changes very, you know, xenophobic, targeting Asians and Chinese especially. But Kenneth, I guess I never asked you this, but were you kind of aware of this historical and ideological context with the Queen's Museum when you first began working on this project and when you were invited for an exhibition?
Not really. I mean, I certainly knew of its place in history, vis-a-vis like, you know,
and you grew up in Queens, no?
I did grow up in Queens. Yes, I grew up not too far from there. I spent a lot of time in Flushing. So that was kind of the entry point, really, right? Like that, I had a particular understanding of that community and the people that populate it, and the young men, right? The young men that live and thrive and circulate and recreate there, let's say. And the Queen's Museum was not something I was quite hip to until later in life. I think the first time I went was like, or Sophia, maybe you know this, but like it was like a baseball theme show. It was about the Mets versus like the Yankees. Mm-hmm. Anyway, yeah. It's totally unrelated, but that was my first
one. Prior to my time, but still relatively recent considering.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know this larger sort of entanglement with the railroad, let's say, but you know, certainly the World's Fair intersects with a lot of things, aspects about our country and its recent development regards to science, technology, and industry, et cetera. But you know, that a lot of that labor is obviously built on you know, the work of people from other countries that are brought in, and so you know, this the instance of the railroads and that labor certainly perpetuates and replicates itself in any number of different industries all over, you know, throughout history in this country. And this is, you know, it's one instance, but I think that, you know, this one strike, I think, you know, I think for me, you know, really resonates, you know, partially because it is completely overlooked, but also it was done in such a sort of surprising and unexpected way. And I think that's like, that's the silence of silent spikes, like the fact that a different mode of resistance can happen that perhaps, you know, taps into some idea of Asianness, you know, I don't want to necessarily define that term, but so much of the video is about thinking of the body and its, you know, and its relationship to sensuality, let's say, and vulnerability as a way of finding affirmation versus, you know, some other model. You know, the cowboy, I use the cowboy as something to push against. I'm not saying that we need Asian cowboys. Like, that's not the solution necessarily. It's the how can we see that, but how can we reinvest it with different kinds of meanings and different kinds of values to allow for broader expressions of identity?
There's like so many directions that we can take this, but we're running out of time as always. So before we end, I guess I would love to kind of hear from both of you what you're envisioning for the exhibition at the Queen's Museum. It's due to open in spring next year, right?
February.
So soon. It's like tomorrow. Yeah.
I think so. It was always going to be a two-channel installation. So this version that we're seeing online at the Guggenheim will be sort of expanded upon. I have a lot of other footage that I can play. You know, the beauty of having it in the installation is that I can allow for more expansive use of time, really. I'm not so forced to kind of like create a compact version of this project. So it'll be more experiential, I suppose I can say, in terms of the way I want to use that space. Overlaid with the footage that I have. And then also there's a sculptural component. I plan on exhibiting one of the costumes that I use in the video. You see brief images of this railroad worker, essentially. That's kind of who I modeled the look after, but he's also one of the participants in the film or in this video. So that'll be on display. And that was, you know, the idea of a costume was always something that I had been toying with. At first, I was thinking about displaying the cowboy costumes, and this sort of taps into the Queen's Museum's history as it's not necessarily an encyclopedic museum, but it certainly has a collection, and I wanted people to be sort of confused when they see this thing. Oh, is this an actual artifact? How does this relate to, you know, the rest of the building, you know, putting it out so that it's not necessarily immediately understood to be a part of the installation. And then there's another sort of sculptural component that I'm working on, sort of this leather-based sculpture. So it's primarily a two-channel with objects that sort of sit in and outside of the space.
Yeah, and the project is going to be situated in the Queen's Museum took over the full building in 2013, and prior to that, we were just in the north side of the building, but this we still have one main gallery, which is in the old side of the building, which is kind of hugging the panorama. So this will be situated there, and it is adjacent to the permanent collection items from the fairs, which are just above it on the second floor. So there is that kind of spatial proximity as well. And, you know, one thing just in relation to the panorama, one thing I didn't mention and the strike is that while the 1964 fair was being developed, there was a large scale protest and strike of laborers working on the fair on the basis of racial inequity and discrimination among the labor practices. And so, you know, while the idea of the railroad is really grounded in the history of the 1939 World's Fair, this project really connects to both in major ways. So those resonances won't be explicit, but I'm hoping that those who know those histories and come to the museum with an interest in its identity as a historical site will really feel connected to this project.
Thank you, Kenneth and Sophia. I really look forward to seeing the show, hopefully with the mask on in person. It'll be really fantastic. And I just want to thank you, you know, for joining us today to talk about the work and the exhibition. I also want to extend a huge, you know, thank you to our public programs team, as well as the Asian Art Circle here at the Guggenheim and the Queen's Museum for making this possible. Don't forget Silent Spikes will be available to view online through our website until Saturday, this Saturday, December 12th. 7 p.m. And also Kenneth and I will be talking more on Instagram through Insta Live on Fridays at noon. So please join us through the Guggenheim account there. Thank you so much, guys, and have a wonderful holiday season.
You too. Thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you.